Hi, I'm Dr. Michelle Lee, and today I'm here with my colleague and work partner, Dr. Kevin Tozer. And today I thought we'd chat about some advances in cataract surgery, such as some new lenses and technologies that we're both really excited about. Welcome, Dr. Tozer.
Thank you.
Cataract surgery has really evolved over time.
A cataract is a clouding of the natural lens inside the eye. It's important to note this isn't really a disease, it's just a natural part of aging. And because it's a natural part of aging, people have been going blind from cataract surgery for as long as people have been around. The earliest known instances of primitive cataract surgery go back to 600 BC when doctors in China and India would do something called couching. They would just push on the eye really, really, really hard and try to dislodge the natural lens from the inside so that it kind of float and settle out towards the bottom of the eye.
It's amazing how far we've come in terms of the way we do cataract surgery. Today, we can perform phacoemulsification, where we use small incisions and a machine to break down lenses into smaller pieces. On top of that, we have some really cool advances, such as the use of laser during cataract surgery. Why don't you tell our viewers about laser-assisted cataract surgery?
One of the biggest innovations in surgery in general in the last 10 to 15 years has been the addition of lasers. In cataract surgery, this comes from what's known as a femtosecond laser. It's a similar laser to what's used in LASIK procedures. Now, a common misconception patients have when they hear laser cataract surgery is they believe the whole surgery is being done by a laser, and that's simply not true. The laser performs certain steps of the surgery, such as making an incision to make it easier to get to the cataract or softening the cataract up to make it easier to remove. But the bulk of the surgery is still done by hand with the surgeon holding instruments inside the eye. Initially, we were really hopeful that the addition of the laser would provide substantial improvements of safety and patient outcomes. In reality, it really doesn't do that. For routine standard cases, there's not much utility with the addition of the laser to traditional cataract surgery.
One circumstance where there may be an advantage in using this laser is when a patient has astigmatism, which means that the cornea is shaped more like a football than a baseball.
I use the femtosecond laser for all premium cases, and those are cases where I'm using special lenses where correcting the astigmatism is really important to get the desired outcome.
I agree. I don't see a benefit to femtosecond laser or laser-assisted cataract surgery in routine cases necessarily, but definitely for astigmatism correction as well as for premium lenses. When we talk about a premium lens, we're talking about a lens that's not covered by insurance.
Exactly. One important point to make, though, is that there's no lens that's the perfect lens for every single eye. And in fact, in many cases, the standard lens may be the best lens for an individual patient. A standard lens is a lens that focuses the eye at either distance or near, but not both. And additionally, the standard lens does not fix astigmatism. Premium lenses can do certain things standard lenses can't. The first kind of category of premium lenses is a toric lens. Toric lens focuses the eye at distance or near, but does correct astigmatism. The kind of next category up would be what's called a multifocal or an extended depth of focus lens. These lenses focus the eye at both distance and near, and sometimes even intermediate, while also correcting astigmatism. It's obviously a lot more versatile than just a distance or just a near lens, but it does come with a couple drawbacks.
Multifocal lenses can be great in some patients, but
one drawback that you will want to consider is that you may have some glare at night.
And if that's something that's going to bother you, I usually advise against the lens. It's a good idea to talk to your eye surgeon about whether you're a good candidate for this lens. So in the United States, the most common multifocal and extended depth of focal lenses that we're using are Panoptix, Synergy, Vivity, and Symphony. In my practice, my go-to's been the Alcon Panoptix lenses, mostly because that's been around a little bit longer than the equivalent lens, the Synergy lens. And I found that I have mostly satisfied patients and overall good results. But I have been incorporating the newer multifocal lens Synergy with good results as well. So Dr. Tozer, what's your go-to multifocal lens?
Currently, my go-to has been the Synergy. I just find that in my hands, I've been getting higher percentage of patients with 20/20 distance, intermediate, and near than I was previously. However, it's important to note that even with the newest versions of the multifocals, there are certain patients that just aren't going to be happy with the quality of the vision or the glare or the halos. And no matter what lens we choose, there's always a percentage of individuals that we'll have to have that lens taken out and replaced.
It's always really disappointing for the patient and the surgeon when you have to remove a lens, not to mention risky, especially after that first few months. It's really important that you have good discussions with your eye surgeon and you really think about your goals for surgery before you proceed with your eye surgery. Another factor that really comes into play when it comes to patient satisfaction after cataract surgery is the lens power that we put in. And our lens calculations have really come a long way since many years ago, but even despite our best efforts, we still struggle sometimes in certain situations to get the best power of lens for the patient.
Yeah, so that's very true. And a lot of work's gone into ways we can improve our lens calculations. Because a surgeon could pick the perfect lens type, but if you don't pick the perfect power, you're still going to get a suboptimal outcome, resulting in a stronger glasses prescription than you hoped for.
There are some really interesting technologies that we've incorporated into our practice to offset some of that risk.
A tool I really like is called the ORA Wavefront Aberrometer. It's a really specialized camera that attaches to the surgeon's microscope so that in the operating room, after the surgeon's removed the cataract, but before they've put a new lens in, you take a picture and some really fine measurements of the eye to either confirm or in some cases improve upon the lens power choice. The theoretical advantage of the ORA is that you're taking the measurements when the cataract's been removed, whereas all the preoperative measurements are being taken through the clouding lens.
There has also been a really exciting lens that we've incorporated into our practice here at Tozer Eye Center.
So what we're talking about now is the light adjustable lens from RX Sight. Traditionally, you pick a lens, you put it in the eye, and that's the lens you're kind of stuck with. And with the adjustable lens, you can actually change the power of the lens after the fact once the patient's healed from cataract surgery. So this is nice because you don't need to be 100% precise with your preoperative measurements. In fact, you can actually be pretty far off, and then you can still adjust that lens down to give that patient that real perfect outcome that they're looking for.
I love offering light adjustable lenses to our post-refractive surgery patients, patients that have had LASIK, PRK, RK, or SMILE. And I also think it's great for our cornea practice. So as cornea surgeons, we see a lot of patients who've had issues with their cornea. Sometimes those lens calculations for those patients can be unpredictable. I love having a lens that we can adjust after the fact.
The downside of the light adjustable lens, though, is that it's adjusted by light. So what that means is, until we do those lock-in treatments after the fact, the patient has to wear very specialized UV protecting sunglasses, because if you put that lens in and the patient goes out and does a round of golf or plays some tennis without wearing sun protection, the sunlight's actually gonna change the shape of the lens in some totally random configuration, and then we have to take that lens out and start all over again. That said, for the motivated patient, it can be a really good choice.
This has been great. Thanks for coming and joining us on the channel. I will have our practice website linked down below so you can learn more about our practice. Be sure to subscribe so you don't miss out. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in our next video.
Thank you for having me, Dr. Lee. That was fun.